It's me, Snake. Are you sure you're prepared to tell the whole story of Metal Gear?
Metal Gear?
Yeah, Metal Gear. I just hope the leaderboard is ready.
Hello? Snake, what's wrong? Snake?
Snake!
The story of Metal Gear spans almost a full century across numerous real and fictional wars. Tackling a timeline this jam-packed isn't easy, but there's one central character to help keep us focused. Big Boss. Keep in mind, there's some games in the series that Kojima didn't write, so they won't be included in this timeline. So, sorry, no portable ops included here. With the caveats out of the way, let's dive into Metal Gear and the life and times of the Ultimate Soldier. But first, let's set the stage. The Philosophers and Cobra Unit, 1918 to 1947. The Metal Gear saga officially starts in 1918. In the aftermath of World War I, a group of the richest and most powerful minds from the US, the then Soviet Union, and the Republic of China form an organization called the Philosophers. Their goal? To use their collective resources and influence to prevent the world's superpowers from ever committing another atrocity on par with the Great War. But, like all powerful groups with noble goals, this lofty aspiration slowly becomes corrupted when the last original member of the Philosophers dies in the 1930s. The group's new generation of leaders are more concerned with gaining power than preventing future wars. So rather than steering away from conflict, the Philosophers become the puppeteers pulling the strings of each nation's government. World War II is a major turning point for the Philosophers. At the beginning of the war in 1939, the members pool their considerable resources together to make a $100 billion slush fund called the Philosophers' Legacy to help ensure an Allied victory. In 1942, they used the fund to create an elite team of super soldiers called the Cobra Unit, consisting of the Pain, the Fear, the End, the Fury, and the Sorrow, led by a soldier codenamed the Joy, or as we know her, the Boss. The Boss and her Soviet teammate, the Sorrow, develop a relationship, and on D-Day in 1944, Boss gives birth to their son on the battlefield in Normandy. The child is immediately taken away by agents of the Philosophers. Now, remember this kid, because he'll be very, very important. In 1946, a large schism begins to form between the American and Soviet Philosophers, which eventually grows into the Cold War. Colonel Boris Volgin, a member of the Philosophers, steals the legacy by hiding it in bank accounts across the world and storing the single record of the transaction on a lone microfilm. A year later, the Cobra Unit officially disbands. Fox, The Virtuous Mission, and Snake Eater, 1947 to 1964. By 1950, the Boss is working all kinds of secret missions for the US government. Along the way, she meets a spry 15-year-old kid named John, or Jack. Over the next 10 years, she trains Jack to become an efficient, dangerous soldier. They even invent a new combat technique together, CQC, short for Close Quarters Combat. But things can only stay peachy for so long. In 1961, a Soviet Union scientist named Nikolai Sokolov begins working on a tank capable of launching a nuclear warhead called the Shagohod. However, once he realizes how dangerous his creation is, Sokolov tries to defect from Russia with his family. Before he can, he's captured in Berlin. In 1962, the CIA creates FOX, aka Force Operation X, to undertake super secret missions, and they put Major Zero in charge. A special forces expert and an old ally of the Boss, Zero creates an even more super secret group called XOF. To provide Fox with tactical support, placing a man codenamed Skullface in charge of it. In the same year, the Boss is forced to kill the Sorrow to save their son from being executed by the Philosophers. Now we're getting to the good stuff. So by August 1964, the Boss's old protege Jack is going by a new codename, Naked Snake. The events of MGS3 take place early in Snake's career, when he's still dedicated to his work as a soldier, and not the disillusioned and cynical man in later games.
Commencing virtuous mission, now.
You see, the US had sent the Boss to Russia to retrieve the Philosopher's legacy. Fox agent Naked Snake is tasked with contacting Sokolov and safely returning him to the West. He drops in by himself, but he's not quite alone. He's got some assistance via radio comms by fellow Fox members Major Zero and Field Doctor Paramedic. Before Snake is able to evacuate with Sokolov, the Boss incapacitates him, recaptures Sokolov, and, by all appearances, defects to Russia. The Boss then gives a nuke to rogue Spetsnaz GRU officer and master of electrokinesis Colonel Volgin, son of one of the aforementioned Philosophers. Volgin then uses the nuke to blow up a Soviet research facility, and because the bomb was made by the US, it looks like the US committed the crime. Not long after the botched virtuous mission, Operation Snake Eater is a go. The United States has to prove to the USSR, and the world for that matter, that they were framed for the nuclear strike. The mission is simple. Naked Snake returns to Russia to eliminate Colonel Volgin and the Boss. Snake is supposed to rendezvous with a Russian operative codenamed Adam, but he instead meets with Eva, who claims to be his partner. Together, Snake and Eva escape from GRU's Major Ocelot and his team. Along the way, Snake defeats the living former members of the Cobra Unit. the pain, the fear, the end, and the fury, and makes his way to Volgin's fortress of Groznygrad, but is captured there while trying to rescue Sokolov. Volgin ultimately plans to use the Philosopher's Legacy to produce multiple Shagohod tanks and start a nuclear war with the US. The sadistic colonel pummels Sokolov to death, hangs Snake by his wrists, and tortures him with some shock therapy. The boss, Ocelot, and a disguised Eva are witnesses to this, interrogation. Ocelot, who is forever the showman, and suspecting Eva to be a spy, toys with her using a game of Russian roulette. To prevent him from hurting her, Snake swings into Ocelot as he fires, losing his right eye in the process. And that's how he gets his iconic eye patch. Snake and Eva escape Volgin's clutches, destroying him and the Shagohod. Finally, the boss then confronts Snake. In perhaps one of the most emotional scenes of the series, the pupil fights his mentor, and before being killed, the boss gives Snake the Philosopher's Legacy. Snake and Eva reach a safe house in Alaska and finally share a kiss. But, as femme fatales tend to do, Eva disappears in the middle of the night, and takes the Philosopher's Legacy with her. She leaves a tape for Snake that explains the boss's true mission. She was never really a traitor. Her true mission was actually to recover the Philosopher's Legacy from Volgin by gaining his trust. However, the US didn't expect him to use the nuke to frame them, which led to them revising the boss's mission to remain in her villainous role and let herself be killed by Snake. Snake also learns that Eva herself wasn't really a Soviet agent, but a Chinese spy sent to recover the legacy. Unbeknownst to either of them, the microfilm that she took was actually a fake. See, the real one was stolen by the seemingly ineffective Ocelot, who turned out to actually be a triple agent working for the Philosophers. You see, he was Adam all along. You remember Adam? And yeah, a triple agent. So if that wasn't crazy enough, he's actually the son of the boss and the sorrow. Yeah, the one born on D-Day. So as a result of the successful mission, the United States government recognizes Snake's heroism. Seeing him as a bigger hero than the boss, President Lyndon B. Johnson awards Snake the title of Big Boss. But to hell with his new title, he never forgets how the US government let the boss be branded a traitor to cover their own asses. Because of how he and the boss were treated by the government, you know, as tools to be used and then discarded, Big Boss grows disillusioned and leaves Fox, with Major Zero following him soon after. Meanwhile, XOF leader Skullface waits in the shadows, hating Major Zero and Big Boss more and more because of it. The formation of the Patriots and the MSF, 1970 to 1972. Next up in the life and times of Big Boss is the wild and groovy 1970s. In 1970, Ocelot brings the Philosopher's Legacy to Zero, and along with Big Boss, Sigint, Paramedic, and Eva, they formed the Patriots, with Big Boss as the face of the organization. The Patriots are a reformed version of the Philosophers, dedicated to fulfilling the last wishes of the boss. By 1972, tensions have grown between Zero and Big Boss. See, Zero believes that the boss wanted the world to be united under a single group's leadership, whereas Big Boss feels that she simply wanted soldiers to stop being used as government tools. This disagreement makes Zero scared of losing Big Boss as the face of the organization, so he secretly clones him in the now iconic project Les Enfants Terribles. Eva serves as the surrogate mother and gives birth to twins. Big Boss was understandably not happy to learn about this and leaves the Patriots for good. Eva leaves soon after, but Ocelot remains with the Patriots as a spy for her. Both Sigint and Paramedic opt to stay as well, but slowly become more and more hungry for power. With all these shakeups, Zero renames both himself and the Patriots Cypher. Big Boss begins working as a mercenary on behalf of the Colombian government. During that time, he's sent on a mission to ambush guerrilla leader Kazuhira Miller, wiping out everyone in his squad except for Miller himself. Sharing a mutual respect, Miller and Big Boss quickly become friends. After this, Big Boss seeks to honor the original boss's wishes, so he and his new pal Kaz form the mercenary group Militaire Sans Frontières, Soldiers Without Borders, or MSF. The goal of the organization is to provide military force for any nation that needs it, just like the boss would have wanted. Peace Walker Incident, 1974. In 1974, the MSF gets a contract from Ramon Galvez Mena and Paz Ortega Andrade, a teacher and student from Costa Rica. Ramon and Paz tell Big Boss that an unknown military force believed to be connected to the CIA has appeared in Costa Rica and, without an army of its own, the nation is unable to defend itself. At first, Big Boss refuses to help, but he changes his tune when he hears what he thinks is the boss's voice in a recording that Paz plays for him. For the mission, Galvez gives Big Boss control of an offshore rig, which the MSF lovingly name Mother Base. From here, Peace Walker gets a little complicated. See, there's guerrilla fighters, AI weapons, a guy named Hot Coldman, and the scientist who developed the eponymous Peace Walker weapon, Huey Emmerich. Now, the ending is the most important part. Paz steals and takes control of Metal Gear Zeke, all while sporting a bikini, super practical I know, with the intent to take it back to Cypher. Yes, Paz was working for Cypher the whole entire time, and she accuses Big Boss of having chosen the wrong path, but Boss simply isn't having it and is refusing to join her side. So in the final fight, complete with an epic, crazy anime soundtrack, Paz falls from Mother Base and is presumed dead. Kaz Miller tells Big Boss that Cypher's true identity is that of his old superior and comrade, Major Zero. Kaz had known this entire time, but kept quiet because Cypher was assisting MSF, even in a, roundabout way. So the Peace Walker incident helps the MSF to expand into a global force, so Big Boss lets Kaz off the hook. Ground Zero's incident, 1975. Sometime after the Peace Walker incident, it's revealed that Paz Ortega survived and was rescued by a fisherman in Belize, who found her floating in the Caribbean. Kaz Miller tells Big Boss that she's alive, and Boss suggests that she be assassinated due to her identity as a Cypher agent with knowledge of MSF secrets. However, Kaz disagrees with him, saying that some at Cypher suspect Paz of being a double agent. Additionally, Paz's intelligence leak coincides with an upcoming UN inspection of Mother Base, making Kaz doubt that Paz is truly an enemy of the MSF. Big Boss and Kaz agree that the best course of action is to save Paz and fellow MSF member Chico, who was captured while trying to rescue her from a maximum security prison, Camp Omega in Cuba. Unbeknownst to Big Boss, villainous XOF commander Skullface knows that Paz is the only Cypher agent to ever meet Zero face to face, meaning that she knows where he is. He manages to get Zero's location from her by implying that the knowledge could help Big Boss, and after getting it, he puts two bombs into Paz's body, knowing that Big Boss will come to rescue her. At precisely midnight on March 16, 1975, Big Boss embarks on a solo mission to infiltrate Camp Omega and rescue Paz and Chico. He finds Chico in his cage, but when Chico begins to panic, you know, Boss is forced to knock him out in order to take him to the extraction site. Chico tells Boss that Paz is dead, but Big Boss isn't buying it and manages to deduce her location from the sounds in the tape he gives him. Boss then finds her in Camp Omega's boiler room and rescues her, leaving on the extraction chopper with both Paz and Chico. En route back to the base, Chico discovers Paz's scar from the bombs being implanted, and the MSF medics are forced to operate on her immediately with no anesthesia. During that emergency surgery, Big Boss is informed that the nuclear inspection had gone off without a hitch and that Metal Gear Zeke hasn't been found. The bomb in Paz's stomach is successfully removed and disposed of, but their chopper loses contact with Mother Base. Big Boss discovers that the base is being attacked by XOF and rushes to one of the base's struts to help the other soldiers escape. Only himself, Kaz Miller, and a single MSF medic are able to escape, boarding the chopper just before the support strut sinks into the sea. While they retreat from Mother Base, Miller, enraged by the MSF losses, I mean, they played him like a damn fiddle, interrogates Paz, but she reveals that she had a second bomb inside of her. So she tries to jump out of the chopper to save them, but does so too late, and the explosion forces the MSF chopper to careen into a pursuing enemy one. The damage done to Mother Base is impossible to hide. The media reports that it's the work of money-hungry private militias, but a scandal ensues when the US and its allies are discovered to be MSF clients. There are no reported survivors from the attack, and Big Boss is believed to have been killed. Big Boss, Kaz Miller, and the MSF medic are actually evacuated to Hospital Mena de Barranquilla in Colombia to have their injuries treated. While there, Big Boss and the medic both fall into comas. See, the medic has shrapnel stuck in his head, impossible to safely remove with surgery. Dr. Huey Emmerich also survives and is assumed to have left with XOF, though he later claims to have been kidnapped. The Phantom Pain Incident, 1984. After 9 years, Big Boss finally awakens from his aforementioned coma, having been moved at some point to a hospital in Cyprus by Eva and Zero's orders. He's greeted by Ocelot, who has been watching over him. Ocelot tells Big Boss that Zero planned to have the injured medic act as his body double and be psychologically conditioned to believe he is Big Boss. And they better hurry. The man on fire is attacking the hospital. They wake up Big Boss's double as quickly as possible. Big Boss isn't entirely in favor of having a body double, seeing it as unethical and a bit dangerous. But Ocelot convinces him it's what the medic would have wanted. And for the sake of clarity, we'll call this medic by his codename, Venom Snake, from here on in. Still wearing his hospital gown and face bandages, Big Boss acts as Venom Snake's bodyguard under the moniker Ishmael to ensure that he can safely escape the hospital and maintain the ruse. So once Ishmael leads Venom Snake out of the crumbling hospital, they witness a number of insane occurrences together. They see the mysterious telekinetic third child, a plume of fire shaped like a humpback whale that swallows an attack chopper, and a ghost-like figure emerging from the flames. Venom Snake and Ishmael attempt to escape in an ambulance, but the vehicle crashes, knocking both men unconscious. Ishmael awakens first, and is then dragged out of the car by Ocelot, who helps him escape. About a half an hour later, Venom Snake regains consciousness and flees the scene with Ocelot on horseback. The two then travel together to Afghanistan. Snake is given a snazzy new bionic arm, and they work together to rescue a captured Kaz Miller. So, unbeknownst to the other members of the team, Ocelot leaves the new Mother Base to meet with Big Boss, who had discarded his temporary Ishmael identity. Ocelot gives him new clothes, a new eye patch, a new motorcycle, as well as a US passport with a new name on it, telling him that disappearing in such a way is necessary. Ocelot informs him that the medic, you know, Venom Snake, will be acting as Big Boss from then onward and truly believed himself to be as such, making the medic the real Big Boss's phantom. And Venom Snake gets right down to work hunting down Cypher, forming Diamond Dogs in the process. He travels to Afghanistan and Africa, recruiting soldiers to the new, ever-expanding Mother Base to help him. Snake's mission is to stop Skullface, the now-defected leader of Cypher's elite Black Ops force, XOF. Skullface felt Zero's vision of uniting the world would create a singular, dominating, Americanized culture. So, the villain devises some lofty goals. He plans to use a parasite to eliminate the English language from the Earth and distribute nukes across the world to create an even, yet nuclear, playing field for all countries and cultures. Of course, he'd still be the one having his finger on the trigger of all the nukes. To this end, Skullface plans to use the ST-84 Sahelanthropus, the latest and greatest Metal Gear weapon. I mean, look at this thing. It stands upright, it's got a sword, it's basically a Gundam. While in pursuit, Venom Snake meets all kinds of characters along the way. He captures the scientist responsible for developing Sahelanthropus, Huey Emmerich. Yes, the same Huey Emmerich from Peace Walker. Understandably, Snake, Ocelot, and Kaz all suspect Huey of selling them out to Cypher when MSF was attacked, so they keep him on thin ice. Huey's not the only one they're watching. Venom Snake also apprehends Quiet, the sniper sent by Cypher to kill Big Boss in the hospital. At first, she and Snake form an uneasy alliance, but her powerful abilities are too valuable not to use. Quiet becomes a valuable ally as she and Snake go on missions together. But one of Snake's not-so-valuable allies is Eli, a commander of child soldiers he picks up while in Africa. Eli has a massive chip on his shoulder, constantly challenging Snake back at Mother Base, only for Snake to inevitably come out on top. Just like with Quiet, the soldiers at Mother Base continue to observe him, cautious of signs of violent rebellion. One teammate they don't have to worry about is Code Talker, an expert forced by Skullface to develop the parasite. Finally, after a number of missions, Venom Snake confronts Skullface. To control Sahelanthropus, Skullface needs the third child's telekinetic abilities, but when Sahelanthropus is activated, the third child uses it against Skullface, wounding him severely. It even crushes the man on fire, who is revealed to be Colonel Volgan. Once Snake defeats Sahelanthropus, he has the Diamond Dogs transport it back to Mother Base, leaving Skullface to be executed by Huey. The Diamond Dogs can't celebrate yet. When they get back to Mother Base, Eli escapes the base with Sahelanthropus, aided by the third child and a number of child soldiers Snake rescued. Turns out that the third child has been helping Eli, drawn to his intense desire for vengeance. And this isn't the last time these two would team up. The third child grows up to become Psycho Mantis, and Eli becomes known as Liquid Snake, one of the clones from Les Enfants Terribles. We'll get to them later. The rest of the gang gets some resolution too, just not happy ones. As if losing Sahelanthropus wasn't bad enough, Mother Base experiences an epidemic of the parasites, causing the deaths of many Diamond Dogs. It's all because Huey was experimenting with the parasites, mutating them into even deadlier weapons for him to sell. Sick of his sh**, Snake finally exiles Huey from Diamond Dogs altogether. At least Quiet's farewell is more noble. When Venom Snake is bitten by a venomous snake, the irony is palpable, Quiet speaks English to save him. The reason she never spoke is because she was infected with Skullface's parasite. Her mission was to infiltrate Mother Base and infect the Diamond Dogs, but she grew to respect Snake and changed her mind. So, with the parasite poised to spread throughout her body, she walks off into the desert to experience her final moments. But what has the real Big Boss been doing all this time? Well, he's grown more cynical over the years. By this point, he firmly believes in the boss's ideals of fighting for what was right rather than for any one nation, knowing how soldiers are used and abused. Free to do as he pleases, Big Boss sets off to begin realizing his long-term plan of making a new military nation, Outer Heaven. From then on, Big Boss uses Venom Snake and the Diamond Dogs Mercenary Company to further the legend behind the Big Boss name so he himself can make preparations for Outer Heaven outside of the public eye.
Hang on, hang on. That's it? There's so much more to the story. Does Big Boss ever realize his vision of Outer Heaven? Why the hell did Meryl marry Johnny Sasaki, the diarrhea kid?
Whoa, Snake. We'll get to it, I promise. I hate to leave you in suspense, but there's plenty more to cover for next time.
Yeah, fine.
And what about you, the second clone from Les Enfants Terribles?
All right. So the leaderboard, ready for part 2.